Hi, welcome to Yung Tuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to what you might have heard but would like to know more in depth. I was told by my friend that I spoke too seriously. So from now on, I'm trying to make this talk a little bit more relaxed, okay? For most people, the infrared absorption by CO2 in the atmosphere seems too complicated to be bothered. Perhaps that is one reason some researchers could treat their hypothesis as a kind of truism. It would appear the case from either side of the debate. That's why I've been trying to simplify some related physical issues in the first place, to invite more people to participate in such an unprecedented exploration of our Earth, the only planet with an inhabitable biosphere in the universe we have known so far. Let's go and have fun. Infrared radiation refers to the electromagnetic wave in the micrometer wavelength range emitted by an object whose surface temperature is a few hundred Kelvin to a cold object. In this context, IR radiation is also called the terrestrial radiation because it has been assumed that the condensed matter surface of the Earth at its mean temperature, 288 Kelvin, emits or radiates in almost the same way as a black body. So far, the Earth's surface has been considered as the sole source for some gases in the atmosphere to absorb IR radiation, such as water vapor, CO2, O3, and so on. Therefore, it is not surprising so many research papers have been published on how exactly such an energy exchange process occurs. First, let's consider a pipe whose length is just a few meters or even shorter, as in the case of measurement in lab. The infrared source and infrared detector are placed at the two ends. Then, the pipe is filled with CO2 gas, as John Tyndall did in 1860. Perhaps many people have known that CO2 can absorb part of the terrestrial IR radiation, predominantly near 15 microns. It means that the amount of the IR absorption should be proportional to the product of CO2 concentration and the length of the pipe. Do you agree? If you still have difficulty to understand this, then you could imagine that each CO2 molecule is a circular target for the IR photons to hit. Those photons whose wavelength is around 50 microns would be swollen by the circular target in the pipe. As a result, the transmitted IR radiation will decrease exponentially. The rate of the incident IR intensity to that of the detected IR intensity is called transmittance, which is always less than one. Here it is a simple formula for transmittance, which is represented by the green curve. If we assume the emission is too weak, which would be the case in atmosphere, then the IR absorption, or to be exact, the IR absorptivity would be A equal to 1 minus T. Notice that the IR absorption A is a cumulative IR absorption from the position 0 to position X, while the transmittance T is an instantaneous value at x. In fact, if we found the first derivative of A called the absorption intensity, then the A is the area under this absorption intensity curve. Can you see that? As you can see, the absorption intensity also decreases exponentially as the pipe length increases with the decay constant alpha. In many a textbook, alpha here is defined as the absorption coefficient with unit 1 over meter in system international. Further, this absorption coefficient can be written as a product of two variables called mass absorption coefficient, denoted by Greek letter kappa, and the mass density of the gas, where the mass density is proportional to the gas concentration C. In passing, that is where the Beer-Lapton law is valid, which was introduced in 1853 by August Beer, bearing in mind the Beer's law is written as absorptance, which actually represents attenuation because it is proportional to log absorption. Here, I simply write alpha equal to kappa C to keep our discussion going. This simple equation implies that both the IR absorption and the IR transmission are non-linearly determined by the gas concentration if kappa is kept constant. But does that imply the dependence of the IR absorption intensity on the CO2 concentration as shown in this calculated CO2 peak by Van de Garden and Happer, have to be logarithmic? Take it easy, we will see. To illustrate this tricky point, I use my favorite 3D plot provided by Academo. The vertical z-axis represents the transmittance. The x and y-axis denote the pipe length and the gas concentration C, respectively. As you can see, for a fixed x value, the transmittance decreases with the concentration, which also shows the cumulative IR absorption A increases in the same manner. If you watch more carefully, you would find that the asymptotic value is always a constant, as long as the pipe length is long enough. For transmittance, this constant is zero. For absorptivity, this asymptotic constant is one or unity. As you can see, the red area in this 3D absorption diagram. This 3D profile looks like the top of those public buses I took in the 1970s. What does this imply? Well, you can now argue with others who use this logarithmic formula simply because the asymptotic value for a logarithmic function is infinity rather than a constant. I hope Dr. Van de Garden and Professor Happer and many others who believe these seemingly empirical formula should be valid will reconsider their claim based on this simple graphical display. Of course, some may argue that what I have demonstrated here is an experiment in lab where the distribution of gas density or the gas concentration in ppm is uniform. In a satellite observation, the altitude are above the stratosphere, and the gas density distribution is far from uniform. Indeed, I fully understand this apparent difference in the experimental setups. Nevertheless, What I can tell you now is this. It doesn't matter, as I will discuss this issue soon as part of my newly developed theory. To illustrate this point, let's look at this 3D diagram for the transmission again. As the color represents the value of the transmittance, it can help you to see different isotransmittance bands with one particular color, such as yellow, green, blue, etc., etc. In fact, these indicate there exists a non-trivial equivalence principle that seems nobody had paid attention to until now, namely, the dependence of the absorption on the gas concentration is equivalent to that on the passness of the radiation. In other words, the absorption intensity at a lower altitude with a higher concentration may be the same at the higher altitude, but a lower concentration. Think about it. Confused? Never mind. I will discuss it again in relation to optical depths, atmospherical opacity, and the so-called emission altitude in the future. So stay tuned, as many related talks will come. Thank you for your viewing. Please support my ongoing investigation by subscribing this channel and making your comments. See you next time.